bottom of the second here in Oxford, Ohio. Dylan Baker, number six, the shortstop up for the RedHawks, hitting 188 so far on the season. First pitch comes in. Big swing and a miss there from Baker. Oakland challenged the first base pickoff ruling, and the umpires confirmed it. Went to review and said that the call stood as that second pitch misses just outside. It brings it to 1-1. Here we go again, and that's just low. Makes it 2-1. Pitcher for Oakland, number 19, Sean Fiketa, the senior from Budapest, Hungary. Second start on the year with a 10.12 ERA as that pitch is low. Makes it 3-1. 9 innings so far in the year if you include the last one that he threw. And that's going to get him. Dylan Baker hit by the pitch. That is his 5th hit by pitch this year. Tied for the team lead now. That brings up Garrison Burrell, number 23, the right fielder, the freshman. Has not gotten a hit yet. Or, no, that's not true. He is 2-for-9 this weekend against Oakland with a double and triple. Took a hefty cut there and missed it. That's going to be 0-1 for the freshman. For Fiketa. The pitch. Curveball just misses the zone. RedHawks trying to add on to their 3-0 lead. Ryland Zabrowski adding to his home run total. His 4th home run of the year. An absolute moonshot. Probably hit Markham Dorm in the past the left field wall as Burrell swings and misses on the 1-1 pitch. Makes it 1-2. Runner on first for Miami, no outs. RedHawks up 3-0. Goes to first. Not in time. Last inning we saw Nick Vardavas, Miami starter, go to first a couple times. Now he is a lefty, so you usually do see that more from lefties. Curveball from Fiketa. A little high, makes it 2-2. But it ended up working for Vardavas and the Miami RedHawks. They were able to pick off Gavin Arsenault to end the top of the second. Top of the second. That pitch outside, that's going to bring the count full. 3-2 for Garrison Burrell. Big lead at first. Here's the pitch. That's fouled off. He's fighting. Burrell, the freshman, was a .487 hitter in high school and was named first team All-State in the state of Indiana. This series, he just played Friday. He was 0-1. And that's going to be poked into left field. And that's going to land for his first hit as a RedHawk. Runner's going to move station to station. Second and first for Miami. And that is going to bring up the second baseman, Tyler Gordon, the sophomore, hitting .222 on the year. Has played and started all 9 games so far this season. 2 runs on the year and 6 hits, including 1 double and 1 triple. The pitch squared up to bunt, but it was high. You would think this is definitely a sacrifice bunt situation here. Last player in the batting order. Second, first, no out. Seems like an obvious bunting situation here, but we'll see. Squares around to bunt again. Gets it down the third base line. That's going to work. He's out, but the sacrifice has been made. It's a good bunt there by Tyler Gordon. Made the third baseman, Brandon Nye, go up to get it. And advances the runners to second and third, and that's going to bring up the leadoff man. Brings up Ty Bastich, number 24, the Western Kentucky transfer. That's going to be fouled off behind home plate and out of the complex. Makes it 0-1. Fiketa set. Here's the 0-1. That's going to be a high fly ball in between center and right. Bussey makes the play. Runner tags. And he is going to score, so it's going to work. RedHawks are going to extend their lead to 4-0 off of the sacrifice fly ball. And Burrell remained at second there. Bussey threw it to third to prevent him from going to third. That brings up number 11, Zach McDonald. Runner on second, two outs. RedHawks up 4-0. Fiketa set. Here's the pitch. Looked a little low. And it was 1-0. McDonald like half swung there, thinking it was a strike. He had like a look of regret in his face, but no need for it. As that second pitch is low, that's going to bring the count to 2-0. Pitch that's high, and that's going to make it 3-0. Wonder if McDonald has the green light here. I would think that he does, but I guess we will find out. His first at bat ended up in a for a double, and then Zaborowski brought him home off of the home run. Oh, and here he comes. All right, pitch was outside. He's going to walk to first. Runners on second and first for Ryland Zaborowski. Twenty home runs last season. Led the team, led the conference. They're going to intentionally walk him. That was expected. And it looks like Oakland is going to. Okay, that was interesting. They had Sam Griffith go from short to second on that last at-bat and then switching back just for that intentional walk. We're going to have a meeting on the mound here. Bases loaded for the RedHawks. Two outs. They could really blow this game open as Ryan Novak will step into the plate. I can't see the Oakland bullpen from where I am, so I'm not sure if somebody's warming up, but I'm assuming somebody is. This is a pretty big at-bat right here. If Miami's able to get a hit here, bring two in, or even three, you could really blow this game open. Novak, the lefty, in the batter's box. Here's the pitch. And that is fouled off behind home plate out of the complex. He just missed that one. 0-1. Four nothing Miami. Novak hitting 400 on the year so far. Leads the team in average. The pitch, that hit him. And that's going to bring in a run and extend the RedHawk lead to 5-0. And that's going to bring up the catcher, David Novak. No relation to Ryan, who was just up. But he's 2 years older. Ryan is a freshman. David, who's up now, is a junior. Is currently hitting 237 on the year and 38 at-bats. scored 7 runs and has 9 hits so far on the season, including a double and 2 home runs. Man, what a home run be needed right here. What, that would really blow this game open here. Here's the pitch. He just missed that one. But that could be a no-man's land. Somebody's going to have to get it. And it's Larson again. He's had a pretty good game defensively for Oakland. All right, RedHawks get 2 more on the board. Right now they have 5 runs on 4 hits, while Oakland has no runs on 1 hit. No errors for either side. We will be back for the top of the third. You are listening to Miami Baseball on RedHawk Radio. Top of the third here in Oxford, Ohio. RedHawks up 5-0. Eric Larson, the second baseman, up for the Golden Grizzlies. First pitch is low and inside. It's going to make it 1-0. Larson was up when Vardavis picked off Gavin Arsenault to end the last inning. So he continues his at-bat here. Gets a new opportunity. He's going to dribble that to third. Zaborowski makes a strong throw to first base and gets the out. One up, one down for Vardavis and the RedHawks. And that's going to bring up number one, the shortstop, Sam Griffith, the freshman, hitting .273 so far in the year in 33 at-bats. Has 4 runs and 9 hits on the year, including 5 RBIs. First pitch, good for a strike. Griffith has appeared in every game this season. This series currently 1-for-6 with 2 runs. Pitch fouled off. Vardavis has been hammering the strike zone so far today. Been very efficient so far, making the hitters come at him and trusting his defense behind him. And so far, it's been working. Only 1 hit given up so far. Here's the 0-2. Buckling curveball tipped into the glove of David Novak, and that's going to be out number 2. Nope, maybe not. First base umpire, Jeff Speck, overruled home plate umpire Daryl Morton Jr. said that the ball hit the ground before Novak was able to catch it. So, new life for the freshman shortstop. 0-2. Here we go. The pitch. High fastball. He was able, just barely able to get a bat on it. Half swing there. I should mention that Sam Griffith is wearing no batting gloves right now. I know a certain listener that I think is listening right now would definitely appreciate that look. Here's the go-to. Outside. One and two. You know who you are. Vardavis sets. Deals. Fouled off once again. He's fighting in there. I'll give him that. Oakland looking to avoid the sweep from the RedHawks. Miami won 21-7 in offensive pouring on Friday and won 8-6 yesterday. 1-2 from Vardavis. A bouncing curveball. Short of the plate. Probably went like 55 feet or so. It almost bounced and then hit Griffith. Be an interesting hit by pitch, but did not happen. It was able to go over the middle of the plate. The 2-2. Just misses outside. And Griffith has been able to fight his way down from 0-2 back to a full count. Three balls, two strikes, one out. Base is empty for Sam Griffith. Here's the pitch. And Vardavis misses low. And Sam Griffith, heck bad bat from him, man. He is able to earn the walk and get the Grizzlies a much-needed base runner. That brings up the leadoff man, Reggie Bussey, the sophomore. Currently hitting .417 on the season. Leads the team in average. Vardavis goes back. Not going to be in time. But his pickoff to end the last half inning, the top of the second, definitely in the minds of the Golden Grizzlies. We'll see if they have many more stolen base attempts as Bussey tries to bunt his way or on, and it works. Bussey bunted with one out down the third base line, tried to catch the RedHawks by surprise, and it worked. Zaborowski able to field it cleanly and made a strong throw to first base, but it just was not in time. Bussey, the speed demon, able to get a hit on that. All right, now Oakland's cooking here with something. They got second first up for the second man in the leadoff order, Trent Rice, hitting .261 on the year. That first pitch is low and inside for ball one. His first at-bat is a hard hit ball, but it just went right to the third baseman, Rylan Zaborowski. So that ball is going to get past the catcher, David Novak, and now the runners are going to go station to station. And the Golden Grizzlies are now really cooking with something here. 2-0 count. Runners on third and second. And this is the part of the order that you would definitely want to have up right now if you're Oakland. Try to get back in this game. Vardavis, the pitch. That's inside again. 3-0. When Vardavis is missing, he is missing low and inside. Something to look for as he tries to get out of trouble here in the top of the third. Here's the 3-0. Once again, low and inside. And Rice walks to third. And now Oakland has the bases loaded with no outs. And the three-hole up, John Longer, the DH and junior. Guy hit in his first at-bat. He bunted with two outs in the top of the first. And Vardavis was not able to make the play. Here's the pitch. Strike one. Looks like Vardavis is starting to settle down there. Novak went out to him to consult. before the at-bat. Big at-bat here for both sides. Here's the pitch. Swing and a miss there from Longer. With his last hit, he's currently hitting 320 on the year. So this is someone that you would definitely want to have up right now if you're Oakland, but he is down 0-2, and he's going to have to fight or get a hit here. Here's the pitch. Strike three. What a response from Vardavis. One out. That's going to bring up Brandon Nye, the third baseman. Not having the best of years so far, hitting 114, but clearly the team has enough trust in him as they still have him in the four hole. Big at bat, two outs. That pitch outside. Same thing we saw last inning, bases loaded, two outs, and Miami was able to get two runs out of it. Let's see if Oakland is able to match that or outscore the two runs that Miami got last inning. Currently 5-0 RedHawks as that last pitch was fouled behind home plate. 1-1. Vardavis sets, deals. A little high. Probably about like stomach high there. 2-1. For Nye. That pitch low. 3-1. Have to give him something to hit here. So far this series, Brandon Nye, 1-for-8 with one run and one RBI in Friday's game. Here's a 3-1, the pitch. Got it. Here we go. 3-2. Two outs, bases loaded. Oakland needs it. They need to get something across here. You know the runners are going as well. We'll see if Vardavis tries to go to first, tries to get Oakland by surprise. He doesn't. He goes, and it's fouled off. A dribbler towards the Miami bench. This is one of those at-bats that really decides how the rest of the game is going to go. A strikeout here, and Miami's chilling. They get to play add-on. But if not, it's a whole new game, really. Here's the pitch. That's hit high into left field. A little bit too high, but he gets lost in the sun. He drops it. That's going to bring in one and two and three. And a bases-clearing double by Brandon Nye. Left fielder Anthony Zarlingo looked like he had it, but then he got it lost in the sun at the very end. He had it in his glove, and then it came out. What a game-changing play there. That's going to make it 5-3. It's a tough break. From what I could tell, it does look like he has sunglasses on. I don't have the best view, but it does appear that way as that first pitch is outside for 1-0. Yep, he just got lost in the sun there. It's a tough break for the RedHawks and a much-needed break and score for the Golden Grizzlies of Oakland as right fielder Ian Cleary is up. That next pitch is a little high. It's going to make it 2-0. Looks like we're going to have a little meeting on the mound here. RedHawks do have someone warming up in the bullpen, but I cannot see who it is. Looks like the fence in the way is blocking my view of what number it is. We saw Novak go out to consult Vardavis a couple batters ago, and it seemed to work. But now, after that mishap by Zarlingo, it looks like Vardavis is starting to struggle a little bit with two straight balls. It is a very crowded McKie Field today. it's a great day out. I see a lot of students out. A lot of people enjoying the sunshine, enjoying this Sunday afternoon. It's great to see. We got the grill next to me grilling hot dogs and burgers and like the smoke. Sometimes it like the wind blows it over here and it smells very good. It's a very great day today. 2-0 for Vardavis. Cleary at the plate. Here's the pitch. Man, once again, low. Low and outside to the lefty, Cleary. That's where he's been missing all day, really. 3-0. Wonder if he gets the green light here. Here's the pitch. He does not. It is strike one. I say he does not because that was middle. If you are not swinging at that, then you definitely did not get the green light. 3-1. The pitch, runner goes. He got a huge jump, and that's going to be hit hard into center field. Oh, what a catch! Zach McDonald made a diving attempt into the wall, but the umpires are saying that the ball must have came out of his glove. Gotta be honest with you, I did not see that. But I got a little excited when he jumped into the wall and it looked like he caught it, but it must have popped out. And it's gonna be a double for Ian Cleary. And that's gonna make it 5-4 Red Hawks. Oakland responding well in this top of the third. Down 5-0 going into the inning. And they're able to get four across in the top half of the inning. As that pitch is in for a strike to number 30, Brandon Heidel, the catcher. Currently hitting 294 on the year. Looks like he's having a meeting with one of the assistant coaches. Not sure what this is about. Whispering something into his ear. First at-bat for Idell was in the top of the second, grounded out to shortstop Dylan Baker. As that next pitch finds its way into the zone for strike one. 1-1, two outs. Here's a pitch. Big cut there from Idell. Makes it 1-2. And a big lead at second for Ian Cleary. Here's the pitch. That's fouled right behind home plate. Vardavis was working very quickly when he was dealing in the first couple innings, but since he started getting into some trouble, he's started to slow down a little bit. Usually he was... That's really outside. Makes it 2-2. Usually when he was firing it off with like 7 or 8 seconds left on the pitch clock, but then the last couple pitches have been like 3 or 4 seconds left. Of course, you get 20 seconds in between pitches here at the college level. Vardavis, the 2-2. Here's the pitch. Breaking ball that didn't break that much. That's going to be outside for 3-2. Full count here. You gotta wonder how many more batters Vardavis has left in him after this. Especially after that meeting. Here's the pitch. Curveball got him. Strikeout looking for Vardavis, and he's able to get out of it with the lead. Oakland able to scrap some runs across, but Red Hawks still lead 5-4. You are listening to Miami Baseball live on Red Hawk Radio. I'm the third here in Oxford. New life for Oakland. They scratch four across in the top of the inning. It makes the lead 5-4 for Miami, as that brings up Anthony Zarlingo, the left fielder. First pitch is breaking ball. Didn't break all that much. Makes it 1-0. Went on the outside there. Big Oakland able to get three across there as they got a bases clearing double with two outs as Zarlingo lost the ball in the sun. And the ball popped out of his glove as that second pitch is once again outside for 2-0. Next pitch, he's able to get the outside corner there for 2-1. New life here for Oakland and pitcher Sean Fiketa, the senior from Budapest, Hungary, as that pitch is low for 3-1. Fiketa on the year so far, 10.12 ERA with a 1-1 record. That was before the game, of course, so it's not updated, as that pitch misses the zone, and Zarlingo will walk to first base. That brings up shortstop Dylan Baker, the junior. Looks like we're going to have a meeting on the mound here. This might be it for Fiketa. Baker's first at bat, hit by a pitch. And that helped start the run to get two runs across from Miami in the second inning, as we have a meeting here at the mound. As far as weather goes, it can't be much better. I mean, it is not perfectly sunny. There's a few stray clouds out there, but it feels great. There's just some slight wind going out and to the left, towards left center, towards these dorm rooms that Ryland Zaborowski might have hit in the bottom of the first inning on a just massive two-run home run. My goodness, you want to talk about a no-doubter. That's what that hit was. RedHawks trying to get some more across here as we have a new pitcher in for Oakland. We will take a quick break, and we'll be right back in the bottom of the third. RedHawks trying to get some runs here. You're listening to Miami Baseball live on RedHawk Radio. Bottom of third here in Oxford, Ohio. Fiketa leaves after 48 pitches, 2 innings pitched, 5 earned runs on 4 hits. As that first pitch goes in there for a strike. Dylan Baker up for the RedHawks. And number 18, Tanner Ware, in for Oakland. That's going to be poked into right field, but foul. Just over the reach of first baseman Gavin Arsenault. Makes it 0-2. Tanner Ware stands at 6'5", 210, sophomore from North Canton, Ohio. The only lefty on Oakland staff, which seems pretty hard to believe. The pitch misses outside. Three appearances so far in the season for Ware. 6 2/3 innings, 10 hits, 8 earned runs, 2 walks, and 10 strikeouts. As the 1-2 pitch comes in, here it is. That's low. Almost got Baker there. Makes it 2-2. Last pitching appearance for Tanner Ware was February 29th against Cincinnati. 2 2/3 innings, 4 earned runs on 3 hits, 1 walk, and 4 strikeouts. As the 2-2 comes in, that Baker rips it down the third baseline, but it is picked up by Brandon Nye. Makes a diving stop. Throws it to first base in time for the out. What a play. One out for the RedHawks. As Garrison Burrell, the right fielder, steps into the plate. Or onto the plate, I should say. I guess you could step into a plate, but I'm not quite sure how that would work, to be honest. First pitch just dropped at the last second. Burrell swung right over it. Makes it 0-1. Just misses the outside corner of the plate there. It's going to even it up at 1-1 with one out. Burrell got his first hit as a Red Hawk and the first in his college career. Now that I think about it, as that pitch finds its way to the strike zone for strike 2, 1-2. Freshman able to poke it into left field, right in front of left fielder Trent Rice, as that pitch is low and inside, evens the count up at 2. 2-2. Runner at second for Burrell. Still looking for his first RBI as a college baseball player, as that is fouled off on the first base side. Burrell, 487 hitter in high school and was first team All-State in the state of Indiana as he fouls another one off there from Greenwood. First action he got was the Saturday game in Columbia, South Carolina, and his first at-bat was against Indiana University in the midweek game after that. Friday he went 0-1 against this Grizzly team, and he's going to get that past the right fielder. That's going to bring in a run. He might get 3 here. Runner comes in easily standing up. Burrell gets to third, and he's going to get to third standing up. A standing triple for Garrison Burrell. What a day for you. 2 for 2 on the day. First college hit, now your first college RBI and triple. How about that? That extends the lead 6-4 for the Red Hawks, and Miami has scored in every inning so far in this game. That's going to bring up Tyler Gordon, the second baseman. Had a sacrifice bunt. Brings the runners from first to second to third in his first at-bat. Or plate appearance, I should say. He's going to bunt again. This is not going to work. Bunted it maybe 5 feet in front of home plate. Tried to catch Oakland by surprise there. Did not work. I will say, though, the catcher, Brandon Heidel, did take his time. It was a closer play than it should have been at first base, but they were able to get the out. Two outs for Miami. That brings up the top of the order. 6-4 Red Hawks. The pitch. In for a strike. the pitch. He's going to bunt. And is in time for the out. What a play by Wade. Miami able to get one more run on the board. 6-4. Six runs, five hits, one error for Miami. Oakland trailing by 2-4 runs on three hits and no errors. We are done with three here. Up next, the top of the fourth, live on Red Hawk Radio. Top of the fourth here at McKie Field. Gavin Arsenault, the hitter for Oakland. That is going to be poked into right field a little high and caught by Garrison Burrell. One pitch, one out for the Redhawks. As that brings up the second baseman, Eric Larson, having a very good day defensively, but offensively has struggled at the plate so far this season. Currently 111 on the year, but he's going to improve that average. That gets past Dylan Baker. And Larson gets a single for the Golden Grizzlies. And that's going to bring up the bottom of the order, shortstop Sam Griffith here. .273 on the year so far. That first pitch finds its zone for strike one. Vardavis still in there. Miami does have someone warming up, though. Here's the 0-1. First goes to first. Not in time. But Vardavis was able to get Arsenault on a pickoff play to end the top of the second inning. Here's the pitch. Finds a zone for strike two. Brings it to 0-2 with one out. Double play opportunity here for Miami to get out of the inning. Griffith first at bat, got a hard-earned walk. That's going to be a dribbler to first base. Not going to be able to get two. We may not even be able to get one. Good play from Ryan Novak there to get it and sprint through first base to get the out. That was a dribbler right in the triangle between the pitcher, second baseman, and first baseman there. It's a good play by Novak to get the ball and take charge there. Brings two outs to the inning. And that brings up the top of the order, Reggie Bussey. First pitch outside makes it 1-0. Last at bat, Bussey bunted down the third baseline. So you see Zaborowski playing about even with third base right now. Bussey inside for 2-0. That was a breaking ball that just hung up there. Almost hit him. Had to move his shoulders out of the way, but did not. 2-0. Here's the pitch. That was able to find the corner. Bussey was not happy about that. I think he thought that was a little bit inside, and to be honest, so did I. 2-1. Looks like Buskey's going to be swinging here. Tricky situation for Zaborowski as that pitch is high. Playing about even with third base. Buskey's always a bunting threat with his speed and bunting ability, but with two outs and a 3-1 count, I don't see a bunt very likely in this situation, but you never know, I guess. As the pitch comes in, just misses the outside corner, and Buskey earns a walk. Now bring up Trent Rice, the left fielder. Oh for one so far today. Last at bat was a 4-pitch walk. That's when we saw Vardavus really starting to struggle there. First pitch finds a zone. 0-1. Runners on second and first for Oakland. Two outs. Miami is up 6-4 right now. Oakland trying to scrape some run across to get back in this game. The pitch, that's going to be fouled down the first baseline and into the stands. 0-2. Vardavus has some room to work with here. I will say Eric Larson at second base is getting a very good jump. I wonder if he's going to steal here as a ball comes onto the field. Zaborowski throws it back into the bullpen. Must have been a bad pitch, or the bullpen catcher is trying to block it. Got onto the field. Vardavus is set. Larson big lead at second. Here's the pitch. That's going to be a dribbler to Dylan Baker. Throws it to first. Four out number three. Oakland not able to get anything across there despite having runners on second and first. Miami still up 6-4. We will be back with the bottom of the fourth inning live on Red Hawk Radio. Bottom of the fourth here at McKie Field. Center fielder Zach McDonald up for the Red Hawks. Last at bat was a 4-pitch walk in the bottom of the second inning. This first pitch going to be foul down the first baseline. Zach McDonald had a tremendous catch in center field at the top of the third inning, but I got a little bit too excited too early as that next pitch is a big swing and miss from McDonald there. Brings it to 0-2. Really thought he caught it. Had a great diving attempt into the wall. Sports Center top 10 type of play, but the ball squirts out of his glove, and Oakland's able to get their fourth run of the inning on that play. As McDonald lines that into center field, Buskey fields it, throws it in, and McDonald able to get a leadoff single for the Red Hawks. That brings up Rylan Zaborowski, the third baseman for the Red Hawks. And this is interesting. Oakland is going to send their shortstop, Sam Griffith, to the outfield. So Oakland currently has three infielders and four outfielders right now. As that first pitch finds the inside zone for 0-1. And not only do they have four outfielders, they are very, very deep. I'm going to guess left fielder Trent Rice is probably playing like 315 right now. That is a high, high, high fly ball in the infield and going to be caught. Brandon Nye with the catch there. Or Brandon Nye. My apologies. They were very worried about Sabrowski's power. And they should be after their after that first at-bat. That's why those dorm buildings and beyond the left field wall here at McKie Field, they were in danger. those windows were in danger on that play. Ryan Novak up for the RedHawks, the first baseman. First, a pickoff throw to first base. That's not in time. Tanner Ware, the lefty in for Oakland right now. Only lefty on their staff. The pitch. That is going to be fouled right above me. If it wasn't for the protecting netting, that might have hit the tent that is right above me right now. Or it could probably went right above or past. Anyway, brings it to 0-1. Ware's pitch. Able to find the zone. It's going to make it 0-2 for Ryan Novak. Novak's last at-bat was a hit-by-pitch. What, just outside. I honestly thought that was a strike, and so did the Oakland bench. They were getting very loud after that. 1-2. Yeah, Novak's last at-bat was a hit-by-pitch with the bases loaded. That helped make it 5-0 Miami. That was their one. That's hit right to the first baseman, and that's going to be a double play. Wow. That was a rocket down the first baseline. Arsenault was able to field it, step on first, make a great throw to second base, and Griffith was able to receive it and make the tag. That is a very unlucky break for the RedHawks. First inning held scoreless for Miami. We are heading to the top of the fifth. RedHawks up 6-4. You are listening to Miami Baseball live on RedHawk Radio. Top of the fifth here in Oxford. Nick Vardavis still pitching for the RedHawks. His first pitch is a little inside for ball one. John Longer in for, or hitting for Oakland. DH and three-hole hitter. His last at-bat was a three-pitch strikeout. That pitch is slightly high. I don't think Miami's bench was too happy about that one. 2-0. Three-pitch strikeout last at-bat. Strikeout swinging. The pitch. That is going to be poked into left field, but foul. That was a dangerous play right there. That would have been a double if it was fair. part of this, currently at 82 pitches. Miami has had somebody warming up the past couple of innings, so I wonder if this will be the last inning for Vardavis, as that is a swing and miss there from Longer. That's going to bring it to 2-2. That was like a half swing there. It's like he started to swing, and then he's like, oh, I shouldn't do it, but then like you can't stop yourself, and just ugly-looking swing. Is that pitch? What a pitch. Caught him looking on the off-speed. One up, one down for the RedHawks. As that brings up Brandon Nye, the third baseman for Oakland. First pitch. Low and inside to the right-handed hitting Nye. 1-0. Nye lost that bat was a big one. It was a hit into left field. Anthony Zarlingo lost it in the sun. Gets out of his glove as that pitch is fouled right behind home plate. And the base is cleared. Brings three runs in. And hopes to dwindle the Red Hawk lead from 5-2. At the time, 2. Later, 1. Now back to 2. As Miami leads 6-4. That pitch high into the left center gap and caught by McDonald. 2 up, 2 down for Vardavis and the Red Hawks. To bring up the right fielder, Ian Cleary.
Right fielder, Ian Cleary.
And his last at-bat was a big one, too. That was the ball that I thought McDonald caught in center field, and it was not, as a nice curveball falls into the strike zone. Starts at 0-1. We have not seen that curveball a lot from Vardavis today, but that was very nice looking for the first pitch. Fastball. Fouled off down the third base line and out of the stadium. Makes it 0-2. This could be a quick inning for Miami in Vardavis. I was thinking out loud this could be his last inning, but if he gets out of this quickly, it may not be. Inning's not going in there, though, as that pitch is low and outside. Makes it 1-2. Whenever Vardavis has missed, he has missed low and outside to lefties, low and inside to righties, as he did once again there. 2-2. Cleary now up to 400 on the year so far. That is second on the team in average in the young season. It's that pitch low and outside and is going to squirt by Novak. Was 0-2. Now the count runs full. I don't want to jinx him, but he has done three straight balls at first that he might get out of this inning. Here's the pitch. And it's high. And Cleary earns a walk there. That's going to bring up the catcher, Brandon Heidel. Last at-bat, struck out looking. And that ended the rally in the top of the third for Oakland. As we're going to have a meeting on the mound here. I think this might be it for Vardavis. Gives me a chance to talk about manager Bryan Smiley. His first season at the helm as Red Hawk head coach. Spent the past 14 seasons at Indiana State. Team last year was really good. They went 24-3 in conference play. Were able to host a regional and make it to super regionals last season. And Vardavis is starting to leave the mound. We are going to have a pitching change here at McKie Fields. We will be back after a quick break. We'll go over the pitching change and bring the rest of the top of the fifth inning to you. You are listening to Miami Baseball live on Red Hawk Radio. Top of the fifth here in Oxford, Nick Vardavas, done after 93 pitches and 4 2/3 innings pitched. 4 runs given up, but none of them earned, so still helps his ERA off of 4 hits. Pretty good effort, I thought. And that's going to bring in the right-handed reliever, the 6'6 freshman, Nolan Hollis from Colorado Springs, Colorado. 4 appearances this season, 4 innings pitched, 7 hits, 9 earned runs, 2 walks, and 2 strikeouts. His first pitch. Outside. Gonna make it 1-0. Very compact delivery. Well, I mean, as compact as it can get for a 6'6 guy. And very fast. He rifles it in there for sure. Brandon Heidel in for Oakland as that finds the zone. 1-1. Hollis's last appearance was February 25th at Middle Tennessee State. 1 3 innings pitched. Wasn't the best outing. 5 earned runs on 4 hits with a walk and a strikeout as that pitch is low. Got to make it 2-1. Does a good job of hiding the ball and with his tall frame. It's got to be tough on a hitter to see the ball until the last second. Oh, goes to first. Oh, man. Not going to lie to you, Ian Cleary was caught leaning there, but he was short enough off the first base bag that he was able to get back in time. Here's the 2-1. That is going to be hit to the second baseman. And one up, one down for Ryan Hollis. Heading to the bottom of the fifth, Miami up 6-4. You are listening to Red Hawk Radio. Bottom of the fifth year in Oxford, David Novak. Oh, just foul. Rips went down the first baseline. It was just foul. Probably 2 inches, maybe not 2 inches, maybe 4 or 5 inches to the right. That would have been a fair ball and a automatic double there. Tanner Ware still pitching for Oakland, the only lefty on the staff so far. 25 pitches in. 6-4 Miami. Here's the pitch. And it's good for a strike. It's going to make a 0-2. Novak in a deficit here. The pitch, that is going to be outside. Makes it 1-2. The pitch, that's going to bounce up. Hit the catcher. And head over to the Miami bench, where they are looking at that baseball in all of its glory. 2-2. Last at bat for David Novak, he popped up to second baseman. the pitch. That got him. Yep, sure did. Nicked him on his right leg, I believe. Almost completely got through him, but just got, like, the edge of the jersey there. Leadoff base runner from Miami. That is going to... Going to bring up a pitch hitter for Miami. Number 16, Evan Applewick, the redshirt sophomore from Madison, South Dakota, and transfer from Indiana. He has not played in the series so far and did not play in the series finale against Middle Tennessee. He did have a good start to the season, though. He had hits in his first two games of this season and hit a home run against his former team when the RedHawks were at Indiana to take on the Hoosiers. That first pitch is outside. Applewick on the year so far hitting 200 with the one home run at Indiana, as I mentioned before. 1-0 count. Here's the pitch. A little low. Looks like he is going to replace Anthony Zarlingo. That's who he's pitch hitting for, at least, as Ware throws to first, not in time. Last season at Indiana, he played in 49 games, led the team in walks, hit 233 with 6 home runs and 11 doubles, as Ware goes back to first, not in time. Had a 9-game hitting streak late in the season from April to May. And has quite the high school career, number 3 prospect, and number 1 shortstop in the state of Florida, as that ball's outside, makes it 3-0, while playing for IMG Academy. And was also an Under Armour All-American, so clearly very decorated. Heck of a talent for Miami to have here. Here's the 3-0, as he finds his zone there, 3-1. Stands at 6 foot even, 210. Ware's pitch, able to find the zone again. He went from 3-0, and now has run it full at 3-2 here. No outs on the inning. One base runner from Miami at first. After the hit by pitch by Novak. Ware throws to first again. Novak's not even getting that big of a lead. This is a catcher we're talking about here. Not exactly the biggest speed threat on the team. Oakland second baseman Eric Larson is standing right over the second base bag as Applewick fouls that one back right behind home plate. 7th pitch of the at-bat. Dylan Baker stands in the on-deck circle for the RedHawks. Ware set and deals and is able to strike out Applewick there. 1 out on the inning. That's going to bring up Baker. His last at-bat, he grounded out to third base, and that was in the bottom of the third inning. Looks like we're going to have a bit of... Looks like we're going to have another... pitching meeting here. Looks like we might have another new pitcher for Oakland here. Yep, we sure are. All right. It's another call to the bullpen. We will be back right after this. Very good performance from Tanner Ware. 36 pitches, 2 1/3 innings pitched. Didn't give up any runs and only gave up 2 hits to the Red Hawks. That's going to bring in Brandon Decker for the Golden Grizzlies, number 55, the 6'2", 214-pound senior from Columbus, Ohio. His fourth appearance on the season. So far, he's thrown 5 1/3 innings, 2 hits, given up 1 earned run, 1 walk, and 4 strikeouts. His last appearance was February 29th against Cincinnati, where he threw 2 1/3 and gave up 1 earned run on 2 hits with 1 walk and 1 strikeout. Going to bring up Dylan Baker for the Red Hawks, the shortstop. The pitch. Little high. Very fast delivery there from Decker. Novak just a couple steps off of first base there. Here's Decker's pitch. A little bit of a softer throw, but able to get it in there for a strike. Baker's last at-bat was a ground out to third base, but was able to advance Zarlingo. That was a great play, if I remember right. It was a diving play made by Brandon Nye, as that ball is popped up and it's going to go behind me and out of the stadium. I must say, I have a very nice position here. I'm able to be sitting outside with the people here. It feels very, very good out. I'll say I'm not complaining at all about this. I'm able to get up and get a hot dog whenever I want. I haven't done it yet, but I'm very tempted to, I'm not going to lie. 1-2 to Dylan Baker. Decker's pitch. Like a half swing there from Baker. And was able to dribble it down the right side of the field, but foul. Count remains 1-2. Very fast delivery from Decker. I don't mean fast as in like the necessarily like the pitch speed, but like he picked his leg up very quickly. As that is going to be booted by Nye, the third baseman, and the throw was off as well. And Baker will get on off of the air from Nye there. Runners on second and first for Miami with one out. In the bottom of the fifth inning, Red Hawks up 6-4. Brings up Garrison Burrell. He is having one heck of a day so far. The freshman, 2-for-2 so far, had one hit to left field, and then last at bat was able to hit the right center gap and get a stand up triple out of it. Brought in a run and made it 6-4. Has an opportunity to bring some more runs again as that curveball finds a zone for strike one. Decker's pitch. Cut and a miss there from Burrell. The right fielder can have quite the day here if he's able to get a hit and bring a run in here. Here's the 0-2. Little late on that. He fouled it off behind home plate. There's been a lot of foul balls like that for both sides, I would say. A lot of foul balls going directly above home plate and over the entrance behind me. Still 0-2. That pitch is low. It's going to get past the catcher, though, and the runners are able to move from first and second to second and third. One and two. One out left. Should mention that eliminates a double play opportunity as well. Let's see if Burrell's able to bring some runs in here. One and two. Here's the pitch. Little high. That's going to even the count up at 2-2. I will say Decker works much slower than each of other pitchers that we've seen so far. 5 left on the clock. Here's the pitch. High once again. When Decker misses, he misses high. That was probably like stomach high, in between the belt and the numbers on the back of Burrell's jersey there. 3-2. Oh, strike three. I think that looked like the same spot as the last pitch, to be honest with you, but the umpire did not agree. And that brings 2 outs to the inning. Tyler Gordon up for the RedHawks. See if Miami's able to scratch a few more here. 2 bunt attempts so far. First one, sacrifice worked. And the second one, he was trying to bring Burrell back home. That did not work. That was a dribbler to second. He beat him. 1 run scores. A second run is safe. And Gordon is able to slide into second head first. Dylan Baker was at second base, and he never stopped. It was a slow dribbler to the second baseman, Eric Larson. And Gordon was able to hustle and beat it out, and that brought in the runner from third. And then from there, Baker, he just never stopped, just rounded third, just went straight home, was able to dive in, and the catcher dropped the ball. And that's going to bring in 2 more runs for the RedHawks. That makes it 8-4 as the top of the order is up for Miami. First pitch, low and outside, 1-0. We have seen some defensive miscues here so far today. That is for sure. 1 error for each side as that pitch is low. And that doesn't include the non-catch from McDonald in center field. It's not an error by any means. It would have been a fantastic play if he made it, but we have seen some balls go out of gloves and that result in runs for both of these teams. Here's Decker's pitch. 2-0. That pitch. Able to find the zone. 2-1. Three and one, runner on second for Miami. Here's the pitch. That misses low and outside. And that's going to bring up center fielder, Zach McDonald. Starting to get into the heart of the order here for the RedHawks. 2 runners on for McDonald. But before that, we are going to have another meeting on the mound here. I'm not sure if it's going to be a pitching meeting or another pitching change. I'm honestly not sure. Last at-bat for McDonald was a single right up the middle to center field. That was right before we saw Zaborowski come up, and Oakland used 4 outfielders. We'll say to do that again, but Oakland has to be very careful here to not walk McDonald here and leave the bases loaded with 2 outs for Zaborowski. For any of that, though, Oakland is going to make a pitching change. We will be right back. It's the bottom of the fifth. Miami is up 8-4, and you are listening to Miami Baseball live on Red Hawk Radio. Aaron Evers in for the Oakland Golden Grizzlies. The senior from Stonewall, Louisiana, has one appearance so far in the season. On the 25th of February against Eastern Kentucky. 2/3 innings, one earned run on one hit, one walk, and one strikeout. He is facing Zach McDonald in a critical at-bat here with two outs. Men on second and first in the bottom of the fifth. McDonald hits it to short. He bobbles it, and he's bang, bang, play, but he's out. Close play there, but Miami not able to capitalize on that at-bat. But they were able to capitalize on the inning. They get two. And after five innings, RedHawks are up 8-4. We will be back for the top of the sixth live on RedHawk Radio. Top of the sixth here in Oxford. Defensive substitution for the Red Hawks. Trey Keels, number 10, comes in the left field to replace Anthony Zarlingo. Keels is an IMG Academy alum and transfer from West Virginia. First batter for Oakland was Gavin Arsenault, and he tried to bunt down the third baseline, but Zaborowski was able to clean up and make a strong throw to first base for out number one. Keels so far has hits in four of his six games with an at-bat this season, has seven walks and four strikeouts, and has started the first two games in this series, as well as versus Indiana in the series finale against South Carolina and Middle Tennessee, as the first pitch from Hollis there rifled in, and a big swing and miss there from second baseman Eric Larson. Right now we are at 0-1 with one out in the top of the sixth inning. Red Hawks up 8-4. Second pitch in and fouled back by Larson. Larson in a deficit, 0-2. Last at bat for Larson was a hit right up the middle. That was right after I said he hasn't had a strong start to the year. So you're welcome, Red Hawk fans. Time on the field for something. I think catcher Novak asked for that. We are good to go. 1-2. Pitch from Hollis. That got past Novak and hit the padding behind home plate. I will say Hollis's fastball, very good, but so far he has not done a great job of controlling it so far in this game. He is just a freshman, so he has time to work on it for sure. If he's able to figure it out, that he could be very dangerous. And he has some off speed there. Curveball, I think, that actually no, that looked more like a slider. That hung high. Went from 0-2 to 3-2. Count count is full. We've seen that quite a bit today. A lot of at-bats going from 0-2 to 3-2 throughout the day. 3-2. Here's the pitch. And Larson's able to get another base hit. Past Dylan Baker. And into left field. Oakland's first runner of the sixth inning. That's going to bring up the ninth person in the order. Sam Griffith, the shortstop. Pitch from Hollis. Low. Larson was just like hanging around first, had an awfully big jump there. I wonder if a steal is a possibility here with Oakland needing to get runs and Hollis being wild, especially in the lower part of the zone, as that pitch is in for a strike. Last at bat, Griffith grounded out to the first baseman, Ryan Novak. It was like a little dribbler in between the pitcher, second baseman, and shortstop as Hollis throws to first. Not in time. Runner able to get in there. And Novak was just able to get it and sprint it as fast as he could right to first base and through first base. Able to take control of that play and get that out as Griffith hits a high fly ball. That's in between short and left, and that's going to fall in between them and past the diving Keels in left field. That was a tough play, especially with the stun involved. As we saw earlier in the game, when Zarlingo was in left, he lost the ball in the sun. That was able to bring three runs in for Oakland. Anyway, Oakland has runners on second and first with one out. So they're able, they have something going here with Reggie Bussey, the leadoff hitter, up. Last at bat was a walk. First pitch in for a strike. Bussey hitting .432 on the year. And it's quite the speed threat, as we saw earlier that he bunted for a hit. Second and first for the leadoff man. Hollis looks back at second a couple of times. Now goes forward. Looked like a change up there, but fooled Bussey. Swung right over that. That's going to make it 0-2 with one out. Because of that bunt threat, Zaborowski is playing about even with the bag here. But I'd imagine with two strikes, he's going to back up, and that's what he does. As Hollis goes to second. Not in time. You can see he's concerned about the runner here, especially with who's hitting right now. Well, we have a time here. Home plate umpire, Daryl Morton Jr., arguing with the Oakland bench. Not sure what that was about. It's interesting. All right. 0-2. The pitch from Hollis. Bussey pokes it right to the second baseman. And that is a 4-6-3 double play. Miami is going to get out of the inning. And Hollis is fired up, screaming at the Miami bench. Miami able to contain the threat from Oakland there. 8-4 Miami. We're heading to the bottom of the sixth right after this. Bottom of the sixth here in Oxford. Third baseman, Rylan Zaborowski. Up for Miami. Hit a mammoth home run in the first inning of this game. That first pitch is down the middle, and he might have done it again. That is off the wall in the left center gap, and Zaborowski is going to have a stand-up double. So we saw this in the last at-bat, and Oakland just did it again. They sent one of the infielders back into the outfield, so they had four outfielders back there, and it didn't matter. That went right over the, I guess I could say, left center fielder's head. If you're going left from right, the left fielder being one and the right fielder being four, the second person, it went right over his head. And Zaborowski easily gets a stand-up double. That brings up Ryan Novak, the first baseman. Pitch finds a zone for strike one. Last at-bat for Novak, he grounded into a double play. It was a hard-hit ball down the first baseline. And as that pitch is in for strike two, Arsenault was able to dive for it, get it, step on first, throw second, and make the tag McDonald there. And that ended the fourth inning. Very hard-hit ball, though. Just unlucky, as that pitch is high. 4-1, makes it 1-2. Trying to bring Zaborowski home and extend the lead. Miami's currently up 8-4. The 1-2. Curveball, but remained high. That's going to even the count up at 2-2. Aaron Evers, still pitching for Oakland. We saw him come in for the last at-bat in the bottom of the fifth, and remains in here for the sixth. The pitch, that's fouled off. Looked like it was right over Miami's dugout, but out of the stadium. 2-2. Evers set, looks at second, and deals, and that, I believe, hit directly foul. Like, right out of the batter's box, went foul. Probably couldn't have traveled more than 10 feet. Evers set, looks at Zaborowski at second. Deals to Novak, that's a knee-buckling curveball there. And Novak strikes out looking. That was a good pitch there. And that brings the first out to the inning. That brings up David Novak, no relation, the catcher. Last at-bat for Novak, got hit by pitch on a 2-2 count as he adjusts his padding there on his shin, or his guard. Not padding. Evers set. Looks again at Zaborowski at second. An extended look that time. Novak hits it. Down the third baseline. It's booted by Nye. Zaborowski going to go from second to home. And he scores. Left fielder Trent Rice decided to throw to second to try to get Novak out. And it did not work. And the Miami bench is celebrating. That extends the Miami lead to 9-4 on 9 hits. That is going to bring up Trey Keels, who was sent in to left field in the last half inning and now gets his first at-bat of the game. First pitch. High. 4-1. First name is Alvin. Alvin Keels, but Trey is his nickname. From Portsmouth, Virginia, the 6-foot, 195-pound sophomore up for the RedHawks. That pitch is low. It's a breaking ball that broke a little bit too much. Batted 271 for Danville in the Appalachian League during the summer and played 35 games, 25 for 29 in stolen base attempts, as that pitch is high. Has a few starts this season. He started the Indiana midweek game as well as the series finale versus South Carolina before then. Started last weekend against Middle Tennessee State on Sunday and started the first two games in this series yesterday and Friday, as that pitch is in for a strike. It is 3-1 with one out. Runner on second for Miami, up 9-4. The pitch. Breaking ball, the broke outside, missed the zone, and Keels walks. That's going to bring up Baker for Miami. Last at bat, he reached on air by third baseman Brandon Nye. The pitch is low. 1-0. Runners on second and first for Miami. Evers is set. Looks back at second. Fires it home. Breaking ball. It's a good pitch. Got in the zone there. Evens up the count. 1-1 with one out in the bottom of the sixth. Evers is set. Looks back at second. That was an extended look that time. And outside. Baker is a transfer from College of the Desert, originally from Tampa, Florida. That pitch hits the outside corner, and we are evened up at twos. 2-2. He's the only member of his JUCO class in 2022 to go Division I. And last season, College of the Desert had one D1 commit. As he hits it to, oh, wow, another air by Oakland. He hit a bouncer to Nye, and he threw it to second base, and Eric Larson was not able to catch it. Just, it sounded like it hit the palm of his glove and just went straight out. That leaves the bases loaded for Miami, and Garrison Burrell. Two for three today. Has a triple. Could really break this game open with another big hit here. Pitches in. Slider hits the zone. 0-1. The freshman got his first two collegiate hits today. First one was a liner into left field. And the second hit the right center gap. As that breaking ball falls into the zone. He's now at 0-2. Hit the right center gap. And sprinted to third base, brought a runner home, made it 6-4. Stand-up triple for Burrell. Evers' pitch, high and outside. 1-2. Another big hit here would blow this game right open. Evers' pitch, breaking ball. Able to bring a run in. He hit it again to Brandon Nye. Another bouncer. Threw it to second. And it was a little bit off target for Larson. They were able to get the out at second, but Larson had to. He had to get one of his feet off the bag, like a first baseman there, to make the out. Wasn't able to go to first there. So that allows Miami to score another run. And now the RedHawks extend their lead by a score of 10-4. And that is going to bring up Tyler Gordon, second baseman. First pitch is in for a strike. First pitch, last at bat for Gordon was a single. right over second base. Fouls next pitch off is now 0-2. 0-2 and two outs. Tyler Gorin on the plate for the RedHawks. Evers' pitch, breaking ball. Strike three, catcher tags him. That's going to end the inning, but Miami able to add two more. RedHawks up 10-4 at the end of six. Top of the seventh here at McKie Park. Hollis remains in for Miami. He is throwing to left fielder Trent Rice. First pitch just outside for ball one. RedHawks looking for the sweep today. Hollis' pitch, big swing and miss there from Rice. He wanted all of that one. He was completely unbalanced after a swing and miss there. Brings the count to 1-1. Miami won game one on Friday by a score of 21-7. As that pitch misses outside. And then yesterday won 8-6. So Miami's offense really showing out today. And has really showed out the past couple weekends against Middle Tennessee State as well. As Hollis deals. That is just over the glove of Dylan Baker. And Trent Rice able to get a leadoff single for the Golden Grizzlies. Offense has really showed out for Miami after their opening weekend at South Carolina where they got no hit. Pitch hitter for the Golden Grizzlies, number 11, Hayden. The 5'11 freshman from Wintersville, Ohio, has appeared in 7 games this season. Currently hitting .278 with a .435 on base percentage and .333 slugging. He did appear in the game yesterday, went 0-for-1. Hollis goes to first, a little high, but Novak able to get it. Very bright, sunny, pretty picture-perfect day here in Oxford, Ohio. This is a beautiful town in the spring, I must say. Hollis hits the outside corner. And that brings it to 0-1. Or the lefty stands in the batter's box. Hollis goes back to first. Ross done good work so far. No runs given up. We'll see if he's able to keep it up through this inning as he goes back to first again. Seems to be very concerned about Trent Rice. He is 7-for-7 on stolen base attempts this year, so there's good reason to be worried about that. Tied for the team lead. And Rice goes. Throw down the second. Nine time. So he can make it 8-for-8. And that takes the team lead now. Solely by himself. Reggie Bussey, the leadoff hitter, is also 7-for-7. So top two for Oakland. Definitely something to worry about on the base paths. And bunting as well, as we saw Bussey get a bunt single earlier in the game. Hollis's pitch outside. That's going to make it 2-1. There is action in the Miami bullpen due to the fence in my way. I cannot see who it is exactly, though. Pitch from Hollis. That time inside. Almost got him. Gonna bring it to 3-1. Runner on second for Oakland after the Rice single and stolen base. Hollis's pitch. Fouled back. If that protective netting was right there, that was probably 2 feet away from me. So, I'm thankful for that, because that would have been an interesting call. That runs the count full. 3-2. Big at bat here. Hollis versus Orr. Hollis sets, looks at second a couple times, deals the first, and that is a hit in the left field. I think that's going to get out, and it is. Time to do it again. Miami in their all-white with red caps. Oakland in their cream-colored jerseys. So that's an interesting color combination. Looks like a summer league game where it's not uncommon to see two teams wearing the same jerseys or jersey color. Orr hits it to Baker. Baker does it to Novak. That's going to be out number one, but Rice able to advance from second to third. One out in the inning. I think Miami will be okay with that, up six. That brings Nye up to the plate. First pitch, fouled back, right behind home plate. Last at bat for Nye. He flew out to center field. Hollis's pitch low again. Novak has to be really careful here. Because Hollis has been, when he misses, he has mostly been missing low. So Novak will have to make sure that his blocking game is on point here to potentially save a run and not let Oakland try to get back in this game. As Hollis deals, that is a high fly ball. That is deep in the left field, and that is gone. Right over the head of Trey Keels in left field. That is Nye's first home run of the season. And as far as the starters go for Oakland today, only the third. The other two have come from Brandon Heidel. It's one thing you can't afford right now if you're in Miami. Looks like we're going to have another pitching meeting here. This might be it for Hollis. Outside of those two batters, very good day for him. Nothing to be ashamed of there. Pretty efficient. Been pounding the zone. Anytime he's missed, it's been low. just a meeting between the between Novak, pitching coach, and Hollis. So I don't think we're going to see a pitching change this time. I think it's just time to settle him down. Well, maybe not. Hollis going to be out of the game. We're going to have another pitching change for Miami. Top of the seventh, one out. Miami up 10-6. Pretty good outing for Nolan Hollis. 31 pitches, 1 2/3 innings pitched, 2 runs off of that home run, 4 hits, and all 4, or I guess not, 4 of his 5 outs came in the ground out variety. First pitch, curveball into the zone for strike 1. That brings in number 19, Nick DeMonica, 6 foot, 185 junior from Cortland, Ohio. No appearances last season, 15 in the season before, as that pitch is outside. 4 appearances so far this year. Last pitched on Friday against this Oakland team. 2/3 innings, no hits, no runs, 1 walk, no strikeouts. As DeMonica is set, there was another curveball in that just missed the zone. It was right there. Another fun fact about him, when I was doing my research on the players and I found his Twitter, I found out he aced a 365-yard par 4 at the Trumbull Country Club as that breaking ball finds its way into the zone for strike number 2, evens it up at 2-2. So, welcome to the Double Eagle Club, Nick. I'm not part of it, I shouldn't say welcome, but that's a heck of an accomplishment too. To get a hole in one on a par 4 as that ball is fouled off over the Miami dugout. I mean, you have to absolutely pipe your driver to do that. I mean, that's unbelievable. I might have to ask him about that. Knee buckling curveball. Gets him looking. That is out number 2 in the inning. That was Ian Cleary that he struck out looking there. That's going to bring up Brandon Heidel, the catcher. First pitch, Fastball inside might stay in the ballpark. That might almost got out of the stadium, but it did not. I thought that was going right for me for a second. We were going to see how strong this tent above me really was. But we'll find out later, another day. 0-1. DeMonica, set. Fouls it off. And is going to not be in play. Makes it 0-2. Last at bat for Heidel. Grounds it out to second on a 2-1. On a 2-1 fastball, I believe. Off of Hollis. That's one of the four ground outs that Hollis got. As that pitch is just outside. Almost got strike three there. 1-2. Nobody on. Two outs. 1-2. Miami up 10-6. DeMonica's set. Deals, and Heidel is able to foul it off. Pretty lively crowd today. There's just a certain buzz in the air when you get this weather. I mean, this is fantastic. I mean, knowing how it is, it'll probably be like 30 degrees tomorrow. I really hope not. I'm knocking on wood as I say that. But I just hope it's like this for like a week. Heidel able to poke it into right field past the diving Novak at first. Golden Grizzly is able to get a runner on after the two-strike hit by Heidel. That's going to bring up Gavin Arsenault. And 2 today. Last at bat for Arsenault, grounded out to third base to begin the top of the sixth inning. As that first pitch is low, 4-1. 1-0. DeMonica looking at the RedHawks at the top of the seventh. Throws the first nine time. We have seen two lefties so far for Miami. Vardavas, the starter, and now DeMonica. That pitch is fouled back. Makes it a 1-1 count. Meanwhile, we've seen one lefty for Oakland, and it is the only lefty that they have. Tyler Ware. Only lefty on their staff. Or Tanner Ware. I should say corrected. That ball is hit in the center field. Going to be caught by McDonald. Time to stretch here in Oxford. RedHawks up 10-6. New pitcher in for Oakland in the bottom of the seventh, right-hander Hayden Manzella, a freshman from Fraser, Michigan. This is his fourth appearance on the year. So far, he's thrown 2 1/3 with 3 hits, 2 earned runs, no walks, and 3 strikeouts. Last pitched February 24th against Eastern Kentucky, where he threw 1 inning with 2 earned runs, 3 hits, no walks, and 3 strikeouts. His first pitch. Fouled off. 0-1, bottom of the seventh here in McKie Park. RedHawks up 10-6. 10 runs, 9 hits, and 1 error for Miami, while Oakland has 6 runs, 9 hits, and 2 errors. As that pitch is low, going to even up the count at 1-1. I do notice he is throwing from the windup as a reliever, which you don't always see, as that pitch is high. 2-1. Usually relievers, you just see them throw from the stretch because they usually throw with people with runners on base. But with the bases empty, he is throwing from the windup as he finds his zone once again, makes it 2-2. Check swing, did not go. It's going to run the count full. 3-2. Manzella stands at 6'3", 203. The full count. Here we go. This is high and outside. Going to have a leadoff runner for Miami. That's going to bring up McDonald, the center fielder, having a very good year so far this season. Right now, hitting .395 on the year, which leads the team. 2-for-3 so far today for McDonald. Manzella in the stretch now with the runner on first. First pitch inside. I'm guessing he must be pretty uncomfortable throwing from the stretch, so this could be a big opportunity here for the RedHawks to extend their lead. The 1-0 misses low. Heidel asked for a new ball from home plate umpire Daryl Morton Jr. And now we're going to have a little meeting on the mound here. This is the heart of the order from Miami. This is the best opportunity for them to get some runs on, with McDonald up now and Zaborowski up next. Those two have done a lot of damage for the RedHawks this season. Each of them hitting 4 home runs so far in the year. Manzella set. The pitch. Low, but McDonald rips it down the right, down the third baseline. Two one. RedHawks up 10-6 in the bottom of the seventh. Manzella looking down at his wristband, figuring out which pitch to throw. Manzella set. The pitch. That's going to be, is it going to get there? Yes, it is. It gets past a diving Ian Cleary, and that's going to probably bring a runner in. Yes, it is. Easily. Runner scores from first, and McDonald gets a stand-up triple. And that's going to bring up Rylan Zaborowski, the best person you want up if you're Miami and the worst person you want up if you're Oakland. Zaborowski. Once again, they're going to have four people in the outfield. They did this the last two Zaborowski at-bats. They've also intentionally walked him. I gotta wonder if that'll be an option here. So you clear up second or first for a potential double play. But being down five, I don't think you want to put runners on the bases, as that first pitch is high. Four, ball one. They're going to throw to him. Manzella set. Pitch to Zaborowski. Curveball, I got him. Every time Zaborowski's up, it's like the whole stadium goes quiet. Everybody's expecting a complete moonshot here. The pitch. Low. Did he go? He did. Gonna make it 1-2. Manziel's been able again with off speed so far. Let's see if he does it again. I would think so. If Zaborowski's able to sit curve here, hit the right side, that is a very, very, very high fly ball into left field. Rice going to be able to catch it, and that is going to bring McDonald home. Gets the job done. Miami's able to extend the lead to 6. Now up 12-6. You could see Rice, like, he wasn't completely sure. I think he got the ball lost in the sun for a second. And he was just like, he wasn't able to get behind the ball to catch it, to get a good throw to home plate. So Zaborowski able to get the job done. We're going to have another pitching change for Oakland here. Bottom of the 7th, Miami up 6. We'll be back after this. Hayden Manzella done for Oakland. 14 pitches and 1/3 of an inning. Novak up for Miami. Ryan Novak, that is. The first baseman. Base is empty. One out here in the bottom of the 7th. Miami up 12-6. The pitch. A little low. 2-0 count. pitch high. The pitch. The four pitch walk for Ryan Novak. The new pitcher for Oakland is number 29, Will Hearn, 6'4 graduate student. Left-handed pitcher, so evidently they have more than one left-handed pitcher. But he has no appearances so far on the season. This is the first we are seeing of him. Looks like he has a transfer from the University of San Francisco. From Buffalo, New York. David Novak up for the RedHawks, the catcher. Already in an 0-2 deficit. Pitch from Hearn. That is high. Going to be ball one. Makes a 1-2 count. Hearn set. Deals. Novak able to poke it in the left field. Going to move his brother up from first to second and bring up Trey Keels, the left fielder. Last at bat for Keels was a walk. Says does not have an at bat today. Second plate appearance of the day, though. As we're going to have another meeting on the mound. Perhaps another pitching change. Looks like he's fixing something on his uniform, perhaps. Oh, it's the wristband. Okay, we do have another pitching change. All right, another pitching change for Oakland. We'll be back right after this. Miami up 12-6. Short appearance for Will Hearn in his Oakland debut. 8 pitches, gave up a 4-pitch walk and a hit to the 2 Novaks. And now in for Oakland is number 10, right-hander Shane McClandon. McClandon, sorry. 6 foot, 165 167 pounds, freshman from Brownstown, Michigan. Three appearances so far, six innings pitched, five hits, 400 runs, four walks, and six strikeouts. Last appearance was February 29th against Cincinnati, where he threw three innings and gave up four earned runs on six hits and had four walks and four strikeouts. Brings up Trey Keels, the left fielder. And he watches a first pitch, the first pitch go high for ball number one. Went high the first pitch, went low on the second one. Makes it 2-0. Oakland really starting to go through some pitchers now. As that pitch finds the zone and is going to make it 2-1. They're going on quite the road trip right now. They were originally supposed to play Wednesday at Bellarmine, but that game got canceled. So they're originally supposed to play Wednesday at Bellarmine, so Louisville, as that pitch is low. Going to make it 3-1. And then they were at Cincinnati on Thursday, and they've been here in Oxford Friday, Saturday, and today on Sunday. So originally supposed to play five straight days. You don't see that a whole lot from college teams. As that pitch is followed back. You only really see that like once you get into like maybe like the conference tournament and some of the bigger conferences. And just like postseason play in general, but you don't see that often. Really testing out the pitching. And they're going on quite the road trip in general. Here's the full count. Trey Keels gives a half effort swing there. Was not expecting that pitch. It's going to bring two outs for the RedHawks and bring up shortstop Dylan Baker. Oakland won 1-3 at St. Mary's in Moraga, California, and then went to Eastern Kentucky where they won 2-3. And then as that pitch is almost going into the Miami bullpen, but it's a fence and bounces in the left field. Trent Rice going to bring it in. 0-1 count for Baker. Yeah, they're going on quite the road trip. After this, Oakland will be heading to Ann Arbor on Wednesday to take on the Wolverines. And then Edinburgh, Texas next weekend. As that pitch is high, going to make the count 1-1. Edinburgh, Texas to face University of Texas, Rio Grande Valley on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And then March 12th, their home opener against Rochester, Michigan. Against Rochester University in Rochester, Michigan. As that pitch is outside, going to be 2-1. For Miami, after this, they're going to head to Dayton to play Wright State on Tuesday. That pitch is high, going to be 3-1 count. And then conference play begins next weekend to get the Bowling Green Falcons for three, starting Friday at 3 o'clock. And Saturday at 1, and Sunday also at 1. 3-1. That pitch outside, going to be a walk. Going to have the bases loaded. Brings up Garrison Burrell. Always seems to find himself up with runners in scoring position today. First pitch high, makes it 1-0. Shane McAldon, he's having trouble finding the zone so far. He's set. The 1-0. Found it there. And Burrell swung right through it there. Gonna make it 1-1. Burrell getting some encouragement from the Miami bench. They keep telling him, do not miss the fastball. Do not miss the fastball. 1-1. Curveball. And a strike. I think he was sitting fastball there. All right, 1-2. Let's see if Burrell's able to fight it off. Get one past the infield. 1-2. High fastball. It's going to be foul. Is it going to be out of play? Yes, it is. Red Hawks up 12-6 so far. We are in the bottom of the seventh inning. Bases loaded. 1-2 count with two outs. Another base hit by Burrell here would really, really blow this game open. The 1-2. Curveball. He's able to poke it right over the shortstop's head. And gets past Rice. And hits the wall. That's going to bring all three runners in. And Garrison Burrell is able to get a stand-up double, a stand-up bases clearing double. And that makes the lead 15-6 for the Miami RedHawks. Really helping out his stats today, I'll say. Has five RBIs on the day with a double and a triple. 3-for-5 today. Have a day, Garrison Burrell. Tyler Gordon up now, just fouled one right behind home plate. Going to make it 0-1. Gordon hitting 233 on the season. The pitch. Low. Gonna make it 1-1. McAlden set. Looks back to Burrell. Curveball. It seemed that I was floating there for a while. Just completely dropped in on Gordon. Swung and missed. 1-2, two outs. The pitch, high fastball fouled right behind home plate, just like the first pitch on this at-bat. McAlden set. Looks back to Burrell again, goes home. Gordon gonna pop it up. And Sam Griffith able to take it in. We're through seven here at McKie Field. Red Hawks up 15-6. You are listening to Miami Baseball live on Red Hawk Radio. Top of the eighth here at McKie Field. Red Hawks up 15-6. Nick DeMonica still pitching for Miami. And Eric Larson is up for Oakland. Larson 2-for-3 on the day. Couple singles. Last at-bat was a single to left field in the sixth inning. DeMonica set his pitch. A little high or a little outside. Maybe both. 1-0. second. Larson dribbles it down the left field side. Almost to the Miami bullpen. DeMonica. Larson makes good contact with it. That's a high drive in the left field. Keels finds the wall. Not able to get to it, though. It's a home run for Eric Larson, having himself quite the day today. 3-for-4 now with that home run. That is his first home run on the season.
A pinch hitter for Oakland. The batter now, number 35, Carter Hayden.
Pitch hitter for the Grizzlies, Carter Hayden, the junior from Phoenix, Arizona, making his third appearance on the year. He appeared on Friday. Did not register an at bat, but did score a run. Fouls the first one back behind home plate, more towards the first base side. 2-for-2 this season. Both at bats were on February 25th against Eastern Kentucky. DeMonica's 0-1 pitch. Going to be high and outside. And even the count up at 1-1. Inning opened up with a home run from Eric Larson and made the score 15-7 in favor of the Miami RedHawks. DeMonica tries to throw a curveball in the zone, but misses just outside, going to make it 2 balls and 1 strike. Hayden has a lot to hit for in this at-bat. He's trying to maintain the 1,000 perfect average. DeMonica, he doesn't want to make that happen. His pitch, high, and Hayden goes right through it. 2-2. From DeMonica. Is outside. We are going to go full once again. Fielder's playing in pretty normal position, maybe a little deeper than usual. DeMonica, the 3-2, high and outside, and Hayden is going to walk and maintain his perfect average on the season. Brings us back to the top of the order, Reggie Bussey. But before that, we're going to have another meeting on the mound. I think we're going to have another pitching change here. DeMonica currently at 23 pitches so far. Still a pretty good crowd, but everybody's starting to part the last couple innings, I think just based on the score. And we had a large student population, but I think there are a lot of exams this week, so I think it might be time to study for that. I know that's what I'll be doing after I'm done with this. DeMonica's going to exit, and we're going to have another pitching change for the Red Hawks. We will be back right after this break. Miami up 15-7, top of the 8th. Nick DeMonica out for the Red Hawks after 23 pitches and two-thirds of an inning pitched. Gave up two hits and one run on the home run by Eric Larson. New pitcher for the Red Hawks is left-hander Connor Breisel. 6'2", 225, sophomore from Sagamore Hills, Ohio. Had 13 appearances last season, 23rd and two-thirds innings pitched, 4.94 ERA with a 2-1 record. So far, he has three appearances this season with 3 1/3 inning pitched. Last appearance was February 25th against Middle Tennessee. Two-thirds inning pitched, three earned runs on one hit, three walks, and no strikeouts. He is facing the leadoff hitter, Reggie Bussey. Lefty-on-lefty matchup. Here we go. First pitch. Curveball in for a strike. Makes it an 0-1 count. With this high-scoring affair, I just realized it is now 4:06, so we are going over 3 hours today. Second pitch, another curveball. Bussey fouls it off. Right behind home plate. Slow dribbler, though. Did not make it to the protective netting behind home plate. Makes it 0-2. Last at-bat for Bussey was a double play that ended the top of the sixth inning. The pitch, a little low. Purcell set. Deals the 1-2. Curveball just outside the zone. Evens it up at 2-2. No outs in the inning still. Both teams have reached double-digit hits in today's high-scoring affair. Not as high-scoring as Friday. We still have a lot of time. There's strike three. Bussey swings right through it. That brings the first out of the inning. Going to bring up left fielder Trent Rice. Last at bat was a hit. Was a hit, and then he stole second for his eighth steal of the year. He's 8-for-8 so far. There's a pickoff attempt at first base. Not in time. A little off center. The 0-0. It was a bunt attempt, but he pulled back. Pitch was right at his feet, but he was able to clear his feet out in time. Bring the count to 1-0. Not a huge lead at first. Three or four steps. Curveball misses low there. Brings up to 2-0. The pitch almost got Rice like to the splits there or something. That was very off balance finish from Rice there. Makes it 2-1. One out in the inning. Top of the eighth here at McKie Field. Red Hawks up 15-7. The pitch. Another curveball. I missed just outside. I don't know if I agree with that, but he's called it there all day, so it has been consistent. 3-1. One out. Pressel let out a big grunt there. Then Rice was able to foul it off. Counts run full again. I don't have an exact number, but I feel like we have had a lot of full counts today. 3-2. Couple looks to first. Here's the pitch. And Rice able to foul it off down the first baseline. Hit the wall and is now rolling right to the right field foul pole, but did not quite get there. Frizzell, curveball, missed. It's going to be ball four. Runner went. But it didn't matter because ball four. Runner's going to be at second first for Oakland. It's going to bring up Hayden Orr. The pitch. Hit the outside corner. Brings it 0-1. Another lefty-on-lefty matchup here. Orr's second at-bat of the game. His first one, he grounded out to shortstop on another 3-2 count. There's a curveball. That was a hard swing by Orr, and he missed all of it. Orr had Rice on second base in his last at-bat and was able to move him to third. Here's the 0-2 pitch. And he missed outside. Fastball missed outside. One, two. One out. Infield playing pretty somewhat deep. Curveball just missed high. Was close, but just did not finish. The 2-2. Low and outside. And yet again, another full count. We are at 3-2. Full count, but first he's going to step off and lightly throw it to second. Or holding the bat right by his left ear. The 3-2 missed low and outside. Oakland's going to have the bases loaded here. It's another opportunity for the Golden Grizzlies to get back in this game. Down 8 runs. Bases loaded, 1 out. You have to get something. You have to get a few runs across here. And it's a dangerous batter up. Brandon Nye, who homered in his last at-bat. Obviously, with the bases loaded, grand slam would really make this game a little bit uneasy for the RedHawks. So we're going to have a meeting at the pitcher's mound. This game has really grinded to a halt the past couple of innings, I'm not going to lie to you. But, I mean, it is to be expected. It's the last game of a offense-filled series. I would imagine both teams are going to be running out of pitchers here today. I would say, really, it's just a game of attrition when you think about it. And there are some more people starting to leave, starting to get tired as the sun is beginning to set here in Oxford, Ohio. Mentioned it before, just a beautiful day today. I cannot find a cloud in the sky right now. It is really cleared up. Very, very nice day. Perfect day to watch some baseball on this Sunday afternoon. The 0-0. Nye up. Breaking ball, broke a little bit too far inside. Gonna make it 1-0. infielders playing a little deep in middle infield and double play depth as that pitch finds the strike zone. And, yeah, Miami's starting to move the outfielders back. They're saying, don't get beat over the top. Keep the ball in front of you. You definitely don't want to give up a bases clearing, double or triple here. As that ball finds the strike zone, makes it 1-2. Everybody playing a little bit deep. Definitely past the bases. The pitch. A little bit high. Not quite able to find the zone there. We're evened up at twos. 2-2 count. One out in the top of the eighth. Miami up 15-7. The pitch. That was a breaking ball. It's hit into left field. And Trey Keels was in the perfect place. How about the Miami bench able to send him back? It's going to bring in a run. It's going to make it 15-8, but not much damage done there. Miami will definitely take that in this point of the game. Two outs in the inning. You'll definitely trade in runs for outs if you're Miami here. That's going to bring up the five hitter, Ian Cleary, the right fielder. Last at bat, he struck out looking. First pitch is a breaking ball that finds the middle of the zone. That was a perfect curveball there. 0-1 count. Miami trying to finish the sweep. Another curveball misses just high. One, runners go. Pitch is low, catcher goes to second, and it is not in time. Was not expecting Novak to go to second there, but maybe he thought that he was going to catch the runner looking, or get, catch Hayden or slacking there, jogging to second base, because he thought he was going to go third. Anyway, runners on third, on second and third. The pitch, breaking ball low and outside, but Cleary swung at it and fouled it back behind home plate. Two, two with two outs. Miami trying to get to the bottom of the eighth. The pitch. Breaking ball. Got him swinging. Oakland able to get two across, but Miami still leads by seven. We will be back for the bottom of the eighth here on Red Hawk Radio. Bottom of the eighth here at McKie Field. A couple of defensive substitutions for the Grizzlies, the Golden Grizzlies. Drew Gaskins going to go to shortstop and replace Hine. And a new pitcher we have. Jackson Esterlin coming in. This is his second appearance on the season. His first appearance came Friday against these RedHawks, where he threw two innings and didn't give up any runs. Gave up one hit, no walks, and threw three strikeouts. First pitch was a ball. 1-0. Miami up 15-8 here in the bottom of the eighth inning. That pitch able to find the zone. That ball, bouncer to third, rifle to first. And one batter, one out for Esterlin. Esterlin also working out of the windup as a reliever. And I would like to add a much quicker tempo than the past few pitchers we have seen, as that brings up Zach McDonald for the RedHawks. First pitch misses the zone. Last at bat for McDonald was a pretty good one. It's a triple into the left center gap as that pitch is outside. 2-0. Now is able to bring in a run. The pitch, McDonald fouls it behind home plate. 2-1. Esterlin deals high once again. 3-1. This could shape up to be a very good pitch for McDonald to swing at here. Esterlin, inside, fastball. Finds the zone for strike two, and once again we have a full count. 3-2 with one out. The pitch. Little high. And McDonald's going to walk and get on base and bring up Ryland Zaborowski. And once again, Oakland is going to sub an infielder in for an outfielder. Or I guess, well, there's no subbing going on. They're going to replace. Well, there's no replacing either. They're going to send an infielder to the outfield. Esterlin set the pitch. Curveball that got Zaborowski out in front. Zaborowski's last at bat was a high, deep fly ball to left field. And that one's going to get past the shortstop. And McDonald is going to try to go from first to third, and he's able to do it. And Zaborowski's going to go to second because Oakland threw it to third base trying to get McDonald. And Zaborowski just never stopped. So now the RedHawks have runners at second and third with one out in the bottom of the eighth inning, up 7. The two best hitters from Miami, McDonald and Zaborowski, both 3-for-4 today, both having very good days. Novak, going to try to get that over the second baseman. He's able to do it. That's going to bring in McDonald. Zaborowski is rounding third. He's going to go in standing up. A two-run single for first baseman Ryan Novak. Extends the Miami lead back to 9. Up 17-8. They're able to match what Oakland did in the top half of the inning. That's going to bring up David Novak. Two for four today. That hit the third, to second, to first. That's going to end the inning. We're going to head to the top of the ninth. RedHawks up 17-8. Let's see if they close this out. You are listening to Miami Baseball live on RedHawk Radio. RedHawks looking to close this thing out in the top of the ninth. They're up 17-8 and looking to complete the sweep against the Oakland Golden Grizzlies. Prezel still in for the RedHawks facing Brandon Heidel. First pitch is a bouncer into the glove of Novak for ball number one. Miami has another lefty warming up. Miami has had, well, they've only had three pitchers. 2-for-3 on lefties today. As Heidel pokes that in the left field. And the Golden Grizzlies are able to get the leadoff man on base. Brings up number 20, Drew Gaskins, who went, That's going to bring up number 15, Ben Clark. Freshman from New Albany, Ohio, appeared in three games so far this season. First pitch, that is going to be fouled away over the home plate and out of the stadium. 5'10", 203, freshman from New Albany, Ohio, appeared in three games this season, batting .500 on the year. He is 1-for-2 so far in the young season. On-base percentage of .333 and slugging .500 as that pitch gets past Novak and Heidel able to jog to second. So far this series, Clark is 0-for-1 but does have one RBI in Friday's game. One and one. The pitch. Good curveball. Clark able to swing right over that. Brings it to 1-2. Big lead at second for Heidel. He goes. Miami throws it down to third. Not in time. Pitch was low, so that's going to bring it to 2-2. I didn't think Miami was going to throw down the third there. I'm not going to lie to you. I thought they were going to let him go. I don't think you have any reason to be concerned about that runner if you're Miami. The 2-2 pitch. is low, and I feel like I'm repeating myself over and over again. We have another full count. Clark trying to bring Heidel home and get a big rally going for Oakland. The pitch is high. Clark's able to walk, and Oakland has runners on the corners. This is Eric Larson's spot, but Pearson Gunnell, standing at 6 foot 201, the junior from Fayetteville, Arkansas, is going to pitch hit for him. He's appeared in two games so far this season. Has not played since February 25th against EKU, and is 0-1 on the season with one walk. So he's trying to get the first hit and bring some runners home. The pitch, swing and a miss there from Gunnell. Then you hear the Miami bench telling Brissell to pick up the tempo a little bit, try to pitch a little bit more pace here, maybe help out more. He has been going a little bit slower the past couple of innings, just since he's been in. That breaking ball, low and inside, to the right-handed Gunnell. 1-1 count. Double play opportunity for the RedHawks here. I'd imagine Clark would steal, maybe. Fouled off. 1-2. RedHawks trying to sweep the Golden Grizzlies. In a very good position to do so. The 1-2 pitch. Swing and a miss. Brings the first out of the inning. Connor Hayden back up for Oakland. Trying to maintain his 1,000 average. First pitch is low. Novak has to scoop it out of the ground to get that one. If this 17-8 result holds for Miami, that would mean that Miami has outscored Oakland 46-21 throughout this series. So, quite the offensive showing for the RedHawks. As Clark steals second, Novak tried to fake the throw and go to third, but Heidel was able to see it. Count is 1-1 with one out. Here's the pitch. Clark grounds it to Baker, throws it to Novak at first, and the RedHawks are one out away from sweeping Oakland. That play was able to bring in a run, so now Miami is up 17-9. As that brings up the leadoff man, Reggie Bussey. 1-for-4 on the day so far. But yet, he is still hitting .410 on the year. So that just proves how strong of a season he's having in this year so far. That first pitch misses the zone at 1-0. Quite the offensive showing this weekend from Miami. You have to be very encouraged about that if you're Bryan Smiley and the coaching staff. As that pitch finds the zone at a 1-1 count now. I think you're right where you want to be if you're Miami, especially offensively. Game against Wright State. As that big swing and miss there from Bussey. 1-2, one strike away from Miami. Miami's right where they want to be, going into conference play next weekend here against Bowling Green. One strike away from a sweep here. Purcell Bussey grounds it to second, to first. And with that, Miami gets a 17-9 win and is able to outscore the Oakland Golden Grizzlies 46-22 in this three-game set and is able to sweep Oakland. Quite a showing. Oakland has had nine runs on 11 hits with two errors, while Miami has 17 runs on 14 hits and one error. Quite the showing. Quite the offensive showing. Gotta be very encouraged if you're Miami heading into conference play next week. Our next Red Hawk Radio broadcast will be Tuesday. Yeah, Tuesday. Men's basketball versus Toledo. And our next baseball broadcast will be Friday as MAC play begins here at McKie Field against the Bowling Green Falcons. I'm Bryan Miller. Thank you for joining us today. I hope you join us for our future games throughout the year. Miami wins 17-9 over Oakland.